Hello everyone. In this series of session, I'm going to explain about the design of short span bridges, or you can call it as design of the culverts. And then I'm going to start with the hydraulic design for the bridges. And in this particular session, I'm going to explain about the hydraulic design of the bridges. Before going in detail to the hydraulic design of the bridges, first I will just brief you about the components of the bridges. So all of you know that we can classify the any civil engineering structure into the two components. One is a superstructure and another one is a substructure. Like, in the same way, even you can classify the bridges into the bridge structure into the two components, one even that is a superstructure and also the substructure. So in case of the bridges, whatever the components of a bridge you will get above the bearing level, whatever the component of the bridge you will get above the bearing level, so those components we'll call it as superstructure. And then whatever the components you will get below the bearing level, that we'll call it as substructure. Superstructure components include deck of a bridge, and then depending on the structural form of a bridge, you will be having a different structural components for different bridges. Say for example, if it is a slab bridge, then as a deck you will be having just a slab. Suppose if it is a beam bridge, then as a in the superstructure you will be having slab and also the beams. So depending on the structural configuration, you will be having different components in the superstructure. So along with the deck, you will be having a parapet, handrails, then expansion joints, and then approach slab. So these are the components you will get in the superstructure of the bridge. Then when it comes to the substructure, so we can call whatever the component of the bridge you have below the bearing level, so those components we can call it as substructure. So you can see in this figure, and the substructural components, you have the wing wall, abutment, pier, and then approach embankment, and then you have the foundation. So these are the components of the substructure. So why I am showing the components of the bridges now, because like you should know the location of these components to know the importance of hydraulic design of the bridges in case of if you are constructing any bridges across the water bodies, like if it is any river, canal, in such cases. Now moving on to the next slide. Here I have the two images. The first image is of the image of a river bridge, and second image it's a road bridge. Now coming to the road bridge, suppose if you want to fix up the dimension for any road bridges, so normally dimension in the sense the span of the bridge and then height of the bridge. Suppose if you are making any road bridge, it is very easy to fix up the dimension for the road bridge, that is the span and also the height. So how you are going to fix up the span? So depending on the road what you have here, so you will be knowing the width of the road, and also you will be knowing the dimension of the shoulder, and then the drainage what you have provided on both the sides. So if you know all these dimensions, so directly you can easily fix up the span for the bridge. And then if it coming to the height of the bridge, so depending on the type of the vehicles which are using this particular road, so based on the vehicle requirement you can fix up the height. So like this, in a very simple way, you can fix up the dimension for the road bridges. I will repeat again, in case of the road bridges, the span can be fixed depending on the dimension of the road, and then dimension of the shoulder, and then dimension of the drainage, what you have provided on both the sides. So by knowing all these dimensions, you can fix up the span. Then to fix up the height of the bridge, so depending on the vehicles which are using that road, so based on the vehicle requirement, you can fix up the height. So like that, you can fix the dimensions of the road bridge. Then coming to the river bridges, always you have to fix up the dimension of the river bridges depending on the site condition and then depending on the flow parameters. So here it requires so many calculations to fix up the dimension for any river bridges. So that's the reason hydraulic design is very important in case of the river bridges. Before going into the hydraulic design of the bridges, first I'm going to explain about what are the basic things which any designer has to suppose to keep in mind while selecting the site for the any bridge across the water bodies. The first point what he has to keep one any designer has to keep in mind is he has to select a bridge site where you have the straight reach of the river. So straight reach in the sense, at as you see in the figure, see here, this is the road what you have, and this is a stream. As you observe in this figure, while selecting a site for the any river bridges, you have to select the site in such a way that you should have a straight reach of the river to the bridges. That means I can say that always the whatever the direction of flow is there, it should be perpendicular to the river bridges. So here while selecting a site in such condition, you have so many advantages. So one thing, when you have a straight reach of a river, you can reduce the span of the bridge. Suppose for example, if you see in this figure, if you provide the bridge in this particular location, that is where I am showing the cursor, then you may require a bridge of a more span compared to this particular location. Okay, so always you have to select the site where you have the straight reach for the river. And then one more advantage when you have the straight reach of the river to the bridge is, so normally you know that whenever you have a curvature in a flow, at the curvature point, so there you can find a lot of disturbances in a water flow pattern. So you can see the, you can observe the more wheels, and then there will be a more cross currents. So that may cause bad effects on the bridges. So in order to avoid all these things, always while choosing a site for any river bridges, designer has to keep in mind that it should be a straight reach to the river. So, and also you can say that the direction of the flow of the river, it should be perpendicular to the span of the bridge. And then one more important thing any designer has to keep in mind, that always while selecting a site for any river bridges, one has to do the preliminary investigation of the river flow pattern. Okay, and then any designer has to select more number of alternate locations. So after doing the survey in all the locations, so whichever is coming more economical compared to the others, and then in that particular location you have to select for the construction of the bridge. So as you see in this figure here, the numbers has been marked. So you can say that, so these are the locations which are selected by the designer for the construction of the bridge. So any designer, what he has to do is, first he has to look into the site conditions of all the proposed locations, then he has to do the all the preliminary investigation, and then basic quantity estimation, and then cost estimation. So whichever is giving more economical one, so that one you are supposed to select for the construction of the bridge. So that particular location you have to choose it as a bridge site. Okay, then the next point is you have to select a site where you do not have a serious wells, or you do not have a cross currents, and then you should have a steady river flow. What is the advantage of having a steady river flow is, as you can see in this diagram, see on both the upstream side and the downstream side of the bridge, you can see that a stone pitching has been provided on both the banks of the river. This kind of works, what we'll call it as a river training works. Normally when you have a steady river flow, then you can avoid those river training works, because when you have the steady flow, then you cannot have the more erosion of the soil at the bridge site. And you know that whenever there is a erosion occurs at the close to the bridge site, so that may cause bad effect on the stability of the structure. So for that reason you have to provide some river training works both on the upstream side and also on the downstream side of all the river bridges. Suppose if you don't have the steady flow, then the quantity of those river training work will increases, then that may lead to the more cost of that project. Okay, for that reason always any designer has to keep in mind that you have to select a site where you have the straight reach of the river, and then you should have a steady river flow. Then one more condition, when you will get the bad cross currents, or you can get that unsteady flow, is when you do not have a flat river bed. That means if you have a more undulation in the river bed, so then that also causes the bad currents. So imagine that in the beginning you have selected some site where you have a straight reach of a river, but in that particular location if you do not have a flat river bed, or if you have a more undulation in the river bed, so that also causes a bad current in the water flow. Okay, so that particular thing also designer has to keep in mind while selecting a bridge site. You should have a steady flow. When you will have a steady flow? When you have a flat river bed. You have to select a site where you have a flat river bed without any more undulations. Then the next important point what any designer has to keep in mind is narrow channels with the firm banks. Now the advantage of having narrow channel is, the one thing is you can reduce the span of the bridge, and then the advantage of having the firm bank is you can reduce the river training works, and also you can reduce the size of the substructural components. So in that way you can reduce the cost of the project. Then the next point is you should have a suitable high banks above the high flood level on each side. So know that banks means these edges of the rivers, will call it as banks. So why we need to have the suitable high bank, mean which is above the high flood level, means suppose whenever the flood occurs, at that time water should not overflow over the banks. So in order to avoid that, you should have a river banks at the higher level compared to the high flood level of the river. Then you should have a rock or other hard strata close to the river bed level. So now the advantage of having a rock or other hard strata close to the river bed level is, you know that you can reduce the size of the substructure. That means you can reduce the size of the supporting structure like pier or the abutments, and also you can reduce the size of the foundations also. So in that way you can make the project economical. Then next one is you should have the economical approaches. As you know that you look into the component, so this is a approach part, that is the beginning of the bridge, we'll call it as the approach. So how we can make the approaches economical in the sense by choosing a stride reach to the river. Suppose if you choose any river bridge in a curvature plan, then you should provide a more dimension for the approach portion. Then that also will increase the cost of the project. So always while designing any bridges, you should have a bridge which is straight in plan, and also that bridge has to be perpendicular to the water flow. Then you have to avoid the sharp curve in the approaches. So, and this point what it says is you should avoid the bridges immediately after the curves. The reason is, you know that in all the curves you have to provide the extra widening. You know that while turning of the vehicles, so in order to avoid the collision between the vehicles, you have to provide the extra width for the roads in the curvature. Suppose if you have any bridge immediately after the curvature, so that extra width what you are providing in that curve part, that has to be carried to the bridge also. So in such cases, normally the width of the bridge will get increased, the required width of the bridge will get increased. So in order to avoid that, you should not select a bridge site where you have a sharp curve close to the bridge site. So if you construct a bridge immediately after the sharp curve, then the width of the bridge will get increased. So then that increases the cost of the bridge. And then you have to avoid the excessive underwater construction. So underwater construction in the sense, like whatever the components you will get below the bearing level, so that all the components that will come under underwater construction in case of the river bridges, especially in case of the perennial rivers. So you know that underwater construction is costlier compared to the normal construction. So for that reason you have to select the bridge site in such a way that you should avoid the excessive underwater construction. So these are the important points any designer has to keep in mind while selecting the site for the bridges. Like collectively what I can say is, you have to select a bridge site which leads to the complete economical project. So first, and what any designer has to do is, he has to take up so many alternative sites for the construction of the bridge. Then out of all the sites which he has selected, he has to choose the economical one. How you can make the any bridge project economical is by keeping all these points in mind. If you select any bridge site, so automatically you can reduce the cost of the project and you can make the complete project economical. But all the why I'm explaining while the all these points, because so these points are very important while selecting a site for any river bridges. But when it comes to the road bridges, like you can these problems will not occur. The problems will occur only in case of the river bridges. So that's why the designer has to be very careful while selecting the site for the river bridges. Okay, so then so you know that while selecting any site for the river bridges, the designer has to choose some so many locations for the construction of the bridge. and then after working on all the sites, whichever is coming more economical one, so that one any designer can choose it as a bridge site for the construction. So now, in order to do all the preliminary calculations, the designer has to select, designer has to collect some data from the site. So here I have the list of the data which any designer has to collect from the site location during the preliminary investigation of the site. So you know that before starting the construction of any project, the first preliminary investigation has to be done at the site. So based on the preliminary investigation, the planning and the designing of the project has to be made. So if you are making any river projects, then these are the list of the data any designer has to collect during the preliminary investigation. The first one is the name of the stream, road and identification mark allotted to the crossing and location in kilometer to the center of crossing. So I think if you have observed at the ends of any river bridges, you can see this information, like you can see that across what stream that bridge has been constructed and what is a RL at that location. So all these locations you can observe on both the sides of the any river bridges. Then you should have a location near to the great trigonometric survey benchmark with its RL. That means you should know the RL at that site. That will help you in doing the survey at the site, and also that will help you in preparing the drawings at the site location. And then you should know the present and anticipated future volume and the nature of the traffic on the road at the bridge site. So this will help the designer in choosing the width of the road and then other dimensions of the components. And also future volume and the nature of the traffic, that will help the designer in analyzing the, that this particular data helps the designer during the analysis, because the live load of the bridge that we can consider, that depends on the nature of the traffic. Then after that, hydraulic data pertaining to the river, including high flood level, ordinary flood level and the low water level. So you should collect the high flood level, ordinary flood level and the low water level, that is different water levels at the bridge site, because this particular data helps you in fixing the height of the bridge. So you'll clearly understand in further explanations. And next one is, you should have the soil profile along with the probable bridge site over a length of the bridge and the approaches. So you know that in order to decide the, in order to do the design of the foundation and also the river training works, so those components design require the soil investigation data. So for that reason, you should collect the soil profile data up to some length on both the upstream side and also on the downstream side, and also you are supposed to collect on both the ends of the road. And then you need to look into the navigation requirements also. But suppose if you are making any bridge across any river or any water body which is used for the navigation purpose, then you have to look into that also, because you have to provide the enough clearance above the high flood level to the bridge deck, so that whatever the ship or a boat which is using that river has to easily pass through below the bridge deck without causing any collision to the bridge. So for that reason, while fixing the height of the bridge, you have to consider the navigation requirements also. And then need for the large scale river training works, like whether if you have any a loose form banks, or if you does not have the high level banks on both the sides of the river, then you have to provide the river training works. So that also you have to take care, and that data also and any designer has to be collect during the preliminary investigation. And then liability of the site to the earthquake disturbances, because you know that while designing any structure have to consider the earthquake also as a load condition. So you need to look into that parameter also. And then availability of the quality and location of the nearest quarries for the stones, for masonry and for the concrete aggregates. And then nearest place of availability of the cement, steel and timber, means of the transportation for the materials, and then availability of unskilled and skilled labor. So why the men and material are so important in any project is, suppose if you have all the raw materials which are required for the construction, if it is available to the available in the place which is close to the site, then you can reduce the cost of the transportation of the material from the available place to the construction place. So in that way you can reduce the overall cost of the project. And also you need to look into the means of transportation. So imagine if you don't have the raw material close to the bridge site. So if you have in faraway places from your construction site, then you have to look into the cheapest mode of transportation. So for that reason, so one has to check what are the alternative mode of transportation that are possible to the bridge site, out of which the person has to choose the economical one. Then very important point is you have to look into the availability of skilled and unskilled labor for different trades required for the construction. Why the labor is important is suppose if you have both a skilled and unskilled labor close to the who are living close to the bridge site, then you can reduce the cost of the overall project. How is suppose if you have all the kind of labors close to the bridge close to the construction site, who are living close to the construction site, then there is no need of providing the accommodation and food for them. Since they are available close, they can manage it on their own. Suppose if you want to get the labors from the faraway places, you have to provide all the facilities for the labors. So in that way you can reduce the cost of the project. Okay, so these are the basic datas which any designer has to be collect during the preliminary investigation of the bridge site. Okay, till now I explained that what are the points any designer has to keep in mind while selecting a bridge site, and also the what are the data one has to collect during the preliminary investigation. So you know that while fixing the dimension for any river bridges, hydraulic design is very important. Hydraulic design in the sense, always while fixing the dimension for any river bridges, you have to fix the dimension for the bridge so based on the some important flow parameters. In those flow parameters, the most important one is the design discharge. Okay, so you can say that design discharge is the volume of the water what you will get at the bridge site during the flood time. Okay, so that volume of water you can call it as a design discharge, or else you can define it as a maximum discharge which a bridge across a natural stream is to be designed. So that discharge we'll call it as a design discharge. In a simple way I can say that design discharge is a volume of a water what you will get at the bridge site during the a flood level, and then based on that data if you are designing a bridge, then that discharge we'll call it as design discharge. So I will say why the design discharge is a more important parameter in the hydraulic design of the bridge. So when you look into these two figures, in the first figure what is happening, the water is overflowing over the deck. In the second figure, the water is not overflowing above the deck, and then bridge is being used by the vehicles and also by the people to cross the river. So normally why the design discharge is very important is, so normally what we do is, the design discharge, as I explained before, design discharge is the volume of a water what you will get at the bridge side. Here what any designer has to do is, a designer has to provide enough a space below the bridge deck so that whatever the volume of water you will get during the flood time has to flow below the bridge. So that should not overflow above the bridge like in figure 1. If it overflow above the bridge during the flood, then you cannot make use of that bridge, then there is no meaning for the construction of that bridge. Same way, if you look into the second figure, during the flood time also the water is not overflowing above the bridge deck, and then it is being used by the vehicles. So that is why the design discharge is very important. So based on the magnitude or the value of the design discharge, you have to fix up the dimension for the bridge. So dimension in the sense, you have to leave the enough space below the bridge deck so that water can pass through that space without overflowing above the bridge deck. So here the design discharge for any river bridges that can be estimated by three different methods. The first one is the empirical formula, second one is the rational method, and third one is the area velocity method. So the empirical formula, this can be applicable for the particular regions, and then rational method, this involves the rainfall and other characteristics of the region, and then area velocity method, this involves the hydraulic characteristics of the stream, such as cross section area and then slope of the stream. So normally any designer what is supposed to do is, you need to find the design discharge by all the three methods, then whichever is giving maximum value, so that value he has to adopt for the further calculation in fixing the dimension for the bridge. Now in order to find the design discharge by these three methods, you need the data. Okay, so from where you will get all these data? So whatever the data you have collected during the preliminary investigation of any bridge site, by making use of those data you can estimate the value of design discharge by these methods. So that's the reason a preliminary investigation is very important in order to make any calculation for while designing the bridges. You need the data, so that data can be obtained during the preliminary investigation. So now I will explain these methods one by one. As I meant, first one I will take up with the empirical formula. So empirical formula, from the empirical formula you can get the magnitude of the discharge using the relation Q is equal to C a power n, and then it has been simplified by the Rives, and then it has given a formula for the design discharge, that is equals to Q is equal to C a power 2 by 3. Here where n was the constant, that constant was given by the Rives, which was equal to 2 by 3. Okay, so Q is equals to C a power 2 by 3. This is the relation what you can use to find the design discharge. And as you see in this figure, where Q is the maximum flood discharge, that is in meter cube per second, and A is the catchment area in square kilometer, and then n is a constant, that is 2 by 3, and then c is a constant that depends on the terrain condition and also the location of the bridge site. Suppose if the bridge site is located within 25 km from the coast and if it is a flat terrain, then you can take the value of c as 6.8. Then if the bridge site is in between 25 to 160 km, then you can take the value of c as 8.5. Suppose if the bridge site is located in some limited areas or some areas close to the hilly terrain, then you have to choose the value of c as 10. You have to take the value of c as 6.2 when you have the a flat terrain, and then if the bridge site is within 25 km from the coast, then you have to take the value of c as 8.5 when the bridge site is located 25 to 160 km and then you have a flat terrain. Then the last case is you have to take the value of c as 10 when your bridge site is close to the hilly terrain, that means where you do not have the a flat terrain condition. So based on the terrain condition you can choose the value of c. So then by knowing the value of c and by knowing the value of catchment area, you can get the value of design discharge by the empirical formula. So this is how you can find the design discharge by the empirical formula. Then the next one is the rational method. So by using the rational method you can find the design discharge with the relation Q is equal to A, I naught and lambda. So here where A is a catchment area and I naught is the peak intensity of the rainfall in mm per hour, and lambda is a function depending on the characteristics of the catchment. So here this particular method is completely dependent on the terrain condition and the rainfall parameters. So we'll clearly understand when I solve a problem on the finding the design discharge. So now I'll just go through what are the relations for those methods. Then last one you have the area velocity method. So as I mentioned, the area velocity method, it is dependent on the flow parameters and the site condition. So it's a very simple relation. So where you can get the value of design discharge, that is Q is equal to A into V, where A is a wetted cross section area of the stream, and then V is a velocity of the flow. By knowing the value of these two you can get the value of Q. So these are the three different relations or methods which you can use to get the design discharge. So now you might have understand the importance of the design discharge. So design discharge will give you the volume of the water what you can expect at the bridge site during the flood time. Okay, so what any designer has to do is he has to create enough space below the bridge deck by providing the proper dimension, whether it is a span of the bridge or a height. By providing a suitable span and the suitable height for any bridges, one has to create enough space below the bridge deck so that whatever the volume of water you will get during the flood, that has to pass below the bridge deck. Okay, so that is a one important hydraulic parameter which controls the geometrical design of the bridge, that is design discharge. So after that I will move on to the next hydraulic parameter, that is linear waterway. So linear waterway is nothing but the span of the bridge, like whatever the span you will provide for the bridge. So the alternate word for the total length of the bridge, we can say it as a linear waterway. Okay, so all of you know that if you consider any river, you can find different types of the soil conditions. Okay, so normally while fixing the total length of any bridge or a linear waterway, you need to consider the soil conditions of the streams also. So what those soil conditions of the streams, I will explain one by one, and then depending on the soil condition, how you have to choose the total length of the bridge. The first condition is when you have the alluvial stream. So you know that alluvial soils are the very weak soil. So when you have a such kind of stream, then you are supposed to take the linear waterway of the bridge across the alluvial stream should be equal to the wetted perimeter or the regime width of the stream. So you know that wetted perimeter means, imagine this is a cross section of a stream. Okay, so whatever the sides of a stream which is in contact with the water when the water level is at high flood level, so that complete length we'll call it as regime width. So you are supposed to take the linear waterway or the span of the bridge which is to be equal to the wetted perimeter dimension of the stream. Like suppose if you do not have the data of the cross section of the stream, then you can find the wetted perimeter of the stream using the relation 4.8 q power 1 by 2. So now already we had the data of the maximum discharge what you can expect at that location, because already we discussed the different methods to find the design discharge. So after knowing the value of the design discharge, the next parameter what you are supposed to find is linear waterway. So if you have the value of q, then you can find the wetted perimeter using the relation 4.8 q power 1 by 2. Then if you have the streams with not completely alluvial, and if you have the streams with rigid boundaries, in such cases you have to take the linear waterway of the bridge or the complete length of the bridge that should be equal to the width of the water at the high flood level. So imagine a stream. So whatever the width you will get, whatever the width of the water you will get when the water level is at its high flood level. So that width, that is a minimum width which you are supposed to provide. That is a minimum length of the bridge which any designer has to provide for the bridges which are being constructed across a streams where the condition is not completely alluvial, or if you have the streams with the rigid boundaries. So that means if you have the streams which is not completely alluvial, or if you have the streams with the rigid boundary, the minimum length what you have to provide for the bridge is, so whatever the dimension you will get when the water level reaches to the high flood level, so that dimension you have to provide for the total length of the bridge. And then if you have the streams with the rigid boundaries, then you can reduce the length of the bridge by some amount. That again, that decision has to be taken by the designer. But when you have a not complete rigid boundary or nor a completely alluvial, then you cannot reduce the length of the bridge. You have to provide the length of the bridge which is equal to the width of the water flow at the high flood level. But you can reduce the length by some extent when you have the streams with the rigid boundaries. So this is how you can fix up the length of the any river bridges. So in this figure you can see the two different methods of river training works. So as I mentioned, you can have the streams of different soil condition. Suppose if you have a alluvial soil, so which is very weak in nature. In that cases, you need to provide the river draining works both on the upstream side and also on the downstream side of the river, so that it should not cause any bad impact on the stability of the bridge. Okay, after the linear waterway, the next important factor which any designer has to be considered and has to know while fixing the dimension of the bridge is afflux. Afflux is a very simple thing. If you put any obstruction for the flowing water, then close to the obstruction you can see there is some rise in the water level. So that rise of water level near the or close to the obstruction, that we'll call it as afflux. So you can see in this figure here, this is a river flow and then you are keeping a bridge as a obstruction. So when you construct a bridge across any water flow, then due to this obstruction there will be a rise in water level. So this rise of water level we call it as afflux. So now, till now we got to know that while fixing the dimension of any river bridges, the first parameter what the designer has to know is need to get the value of design discharge. So based on the magnitude of the design discharge, you have to fix up the dimension of the bridge. That is, you can fix up the length of the bridge and also the height of the bridge. Then after that we discussed about the linear waterway. So linear waterway is nothing but the length of the bridge. So you got to know that length of the bridge that can be fixed depending on the design discharge and also the soil conditions. Then after fixing the length of the bridge, then the next thing is you need to fix up the height for the bridge. So always the height of the bridge has to be fixed depending on the depth of the water flow at the during the flood time. Along with that, you have to provide the additional height by considering the afflux. Suppose if you don't consider the afflux while providing the height for any bridges, then you know that if you put any obstruction for the water flow close to the obstruction, there will be some rise in the water level. So because of afflux, there is a chance of overflow of the water over the deck. So for that reason, while fixing the height of the bridge deck along with the high flood level, you have to add up the afflux to while providing the height for the bridge. So here afflux can be calculated by two different relations, Molesworth formula and then Merriman's formula. So this I will explain while solving the problem. So in this session till now we discussed about the geometrical design of the river bridges. So that is what are the hydraulic parameters which controls the geometrical design of the river bridges. So by knowing all those parameters, so and also we discussed how to fix up the dimension of the river bridges. After discussing about the hydraulic parameters, so I think this slide will give you the a clear picture about the importance of hydraulic parameters. So you know that the geometrical design of any river bridges means geometrical design in the sense dimensioning. So dimension of the any bridge includes the total length of the bridge and then height of the bridge. So as we discussed before, you know that the length of any river bridges, so that we'll call it as a linear waterway. So you have to fix the linear waterway depending on the magnitude of design discharge and the bridge site condition. So as we discussed, depending on the soil condition at the site, you have to choose the a suitable dimension for the bridge. So that is about how you can fix up the total length of the bridge. Length of the bridge is dependent on design discharge and the bridge site condition. Then while fixing the height of the bridge, you need to consider these parameters in mind. So the total height, what you will provide for any bridge, imagine this bottom line is a riverbed and the top line is a bottom of the bridge deck. So whatever the height you will provide, that should be equal to the high flood level. So this is a water level during the flood, plus above which you have to leave a space for afflux. If you don't consider the afflux, then there is a chance of overflow. You know that when you have any obstruction for the water flow, then there will be a rise in water level. Okay, so for that reason, along with the high flood level, you have to consider the afflux also. Then with these two values, you have to provide a minimum value of the vertical clearance. So why we need to provide the vertical clearance? Because you know that during the flood time or during the rainy season, so there is a chance that water may carry some solid objects with it, so during its flow. So whatever the solid objects that the river water carries during the rain time, so that may get obstructed at the bridge site. So when it get obstructed, that will reduce the some amount of the space whatever you have providing below the bridge deck. So in order to have a safety in that purpose, you should have a vertical clearance. Normally, if the span of the bridge say 10 meter, so then the minimum vertical clearance what you are supposed to provide is 0.3. So always whatever the vertical clearance we provide, that depends on the span of the bridge. If the span is within if the span is within 10 meter, then the vertical clearance should be between 0.3 to 0.5. So if it is more than 10 meter, then the vertical clearance you are supposed to provide a minimum of 1 meter. So again, it depends on the site condition. So then along with that, you have to consider the navigation requirements also. So this navigation requirement, this will not come in all the cases. Like suppose if any water body is using for the navigation purpose, then you need to consider the height of the navigable objects, whether it is a ship or a boat. You need to consider the height of those navigable bodies also, and then you have to provide enough space below the bridge deck and above the high flood level of the water, so that those any ships or the boats that has to pass through the bridge without causing any collision to it. So this is how you are supposed to fix up the dimension of the bridge. Length of the bridge is dependent on the design discharge and the bridge site condition. So the height you can fix by adding high flood level, afflux, vertical clearance, and then navigation requirement. So this is optional one. So this will not come in all the cases. If any water body, if it is used for the navigation purpose, so then you have to provide a clearance for the navigation, or else this last one is not required. That is, navigation requirement is not necessary. But in all the other cases, you have to provide the height based on the high flood level, afflux, and the vertical clearance. So this is how you can fix up the dimension for the river bridges. So in this session, I discussed about the hydraulic design of the bridges, and also I had covered the topics, mainly the flow parameters which you are supposed to consider in fixing the geometrical design of the bridges. So the flow parameters, in the sense the design discharge, the linear waterway, and then the afflux. And also I explained how to fix the dimension for any river bridges by knowing the flow parameters. So in the next session, I am going to solve few problems on how to fix up the dimension for the river bridges by using the data which you have collected during the preliminary investigation. Thank you.